Happy Friday, everyone, and welcome to Mom at Home. We have a wonderful show with friend of the museum and harp guitarist extraordinaire, Muriel Anderson. She's performed here at the museum for about a half dozen times, and she's had countless appearances at the NAMM show. The first time I got to see Muriel play live was in 2017 at the Harp Guitar Gathering here at the Museum of Making Music. We had a special exhibition going on with harp guitars, and there were performances there, and it was truly mesmerizing. So if you ever have a chance to go see a harp guitarist perform live, I highly recommend it. So without further delay, here is Muriel Anderson with and hosted by the museum's very own wizard on the guitar, Bill Kilpatrick.
Muriel, welcome, and
thank you. Nice to be here.
I almost don't even want to speak after that. It was so beautiful. I felt, you made me feel like I was sitting on the front porch on a beautiful winter snowy night with a nice glass of wine and just enjoying the beauty of music. Thank you so
well,
much.
Well, we are sitting on the front porch on a beautiful summer evening here in Long Island, actually, and I have my instruments amplified a little bit because there's some fishing boats going by from time to time that sound their horns, and so have a little bit more, and the birds get kind of loud here too, you know.
You know, though, hearing sort of nature, birds in particular, while live music is being played, to me it enhances it. And with the little bit of reverb you have going there, it's just the whole picture. Let's just hope that the fishing boat's horns are in the same key, and I think we got this all dialed in.
That's right.
So, yeah. Gosh, a million questions. But before we get there, Muriel, I would like to read your bio here, if that's okay with you, because it's just stellar.
Okay, don't embarrass me too much now.
I don't think I can with what I'm looking at in front of me. Obviously, you are a harp guitarist. You are a guitarist as well, well known for both of those instruments. You also compose and you sing. So you're the total package.
Well,
it says here. I hope that didn't embarrass you. To me, that's the real deal. Your playing, as we just heard, reflects a sense of grace and joy. interspersed with humor. I think we'll hear some little humorous examples as we go. You have the distinction of being the first woman to have won the National Fingerstyle Guitar Championship. Your double CD, which I'm fortunate enough to own a copy of, Nightlight Daylight, was chosen as one of the top 10 CDs of the decade by Guitar Player magazine. And that's sort of the Bible for guitarists. That is no small accomplishment. And you have performed with a multitude of very well-known people, Chet Atkins, Les Paul, Victor Wooten, Victor we've also had at the museum. So you're in some great company. A couple more things and we'll get going with some questions. You have a current release called Acoustic Chef. Not only is it music from around the world, but it comes with a cookbook of recipes and stories to go with each song. There you go. How wonderful is that?
Yeah.
Love it. And, I mean, you are just staying real busy here. You've adapted to the current times. You have a True Fire channel, which brings your teaching to a wider audience. You're also host of the renowned Muriel Anderson's All-Star Guitar Night and founder of the Music for Life Alliance charity. I just don't know when you have time to rest with all this going on. I want to make sure that everybody knows they can find information about your current projects, your upcoming live streams, your fingerstyle channel, a gifts tip jar link, and so much more. And this will be found at murielanderson.com/now. Viewers, if you didn't get all that when I said it, just go to the links page underneath the promo for today's event, and you'll find all that information there. Muriel, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for inviting me to join you here. So I've always really admired what the Museum of Making Music does and all the wonderful instruments that are featured and the way it promotes music, and especially for kids that need to do hands-on music. I think that's so needed now.
Amen. I know you've played several concerts at the museum. I don't know if you've ever been there during the day when we've had any of our school tours come in. But what you said just nailed it, because we have children who, some of whom have never picked up an instrument before, just haven't had the opportunity. And literally, some of them burst into tears with the excitement of sitting on the floor and playing a banjo.
That's great.
Yeah, it is wonderful. So you started this out with a beautiful piece. I'm going to let you tell everybody what that piece is called. And then if you would, just give us sort of a rundown of what we're seeing here.
Okay. That was Why Worry by Mark Knopfler of Dire Straits. So I thought that would be an appropriate tune to start with. And in fact, when I first played it on, it was actually a folding harp guitar built by Brunner Guitars in Switzerland. I played it and he put it on his YouTube and it got picked up and got some 6 million views. So it's a tune and an instrument, I think, whose time has come. The harp guitar. This one that I'm playing is not my standard harp guitar that I tour with. My tour de force harp guitar is built by Mike Doolin. And this one, like my Doolin guitar, has 7 extra bass strings. And they just move down in a scale. And most harp guitars that you'll see have 6 bass strings, but there's no standard number. It's just most of the time we see 6 on the sub basses. And this also has levers so I can change the tuning a half step. And that allows me to play in different keys more easily since it's tuned to a scale diatonically. And then this part is just tuned as a regular guitar. And what I have attached here is these are super trebles, and it has a pickup that amplifies it so you can hear it a little bit better. And these are attached, they can be attached to any instrument. You can put it on a regular guitar and turn your guitar into a harp guitar, because legally it has resonating strings. So a harp guitar is a regular guitar that has non-fretted strings. So that's what differentiates it from a double neck guitar. We've got a whole nother neck, a whole nother set of frets to deal with. So these are just resonating like a harp. And so most harp guitars only have the basses, but when I recorded an album with, it was Harp Guitars Under the Stars that I recorded. With John Doan. He has super trebles on his. And so I asked if it was possible to have attachable super trebles. And so Luke Brunner in Switzerland built these for me. And so he's calling them Muriel trebles, even though, you know, there's other people who've certainly played with having an attachable set. And I know Harold Peterstorfer has built some for himself. And Keith Medley built his own instrument. So everyone is building them differently. So it's kind of a world of discovery, since every instrument is a little different.
You couldn't have come join us at a more perfect time. A week ago, we had Deborah Henson Conant, and her story really is very similar to yours in the sense that she had an idea, suggested it, and it became a reality. And I think that's what we just learned about your detachable super treble strings. Yeah. Additionally, her carbon fiber harp has the tunable levers, so she can tune a half. Now, is it half step up or a half step down?
Half step up, yes. But, you know, depending on how you set it. And so if I'm tuning, sometimes I'll use them in the middle of a tune, and sometimes just to change the tuning more quickly when I go to a different tune.
Okay. And from the very lowest bass note then on a guitar such as this all the way to the highest super treble, how large of a range is that, note-wise, or just octave-wise?
Your regular guitar, you know, has two octaves there, and then this expands it another octave with the sub basses, and then if I add the super trebles, that gives an octave more. So you've got two more octaves, so a total of five octaves that you can go.
I mean, that's kind of close to piano range.
Well, actually, yeah, when you include, yeah, it starts really at the 12th fret. So if you consider that, you've got three octaves all the way up to the 12th fret, you know, and then yet another. So,
wow. So you've got quite a wide range of color palettes to choose from. Let me back up just a little bit. You talked about the additional neck having resonator strings on it. I think viewers can see that there are no frets on the resonator neck. Is there ever an occasion where you might, say, push down on one of those strings with a finger a la sitar, or does that just deaden the string?
Sometimes I do. So if I want another note, I can sometimes just grab it like this to grab that note if I don't have the half-step tuners. And so there, also I know that Andy Wahlberg was a great player in Florida. He takes the note and then pushes his palm down here. So like that to get a chromatic note. And in order to fret it, to change keys for different songs, he'll stick a little cork here. And so a little cork becomes a little bass string capo.
That's amazing. That's necessity is the mother of invention right there. That's fantastic. Right. So you could then theoretically stop the string all the way up the length of the string?
You can by grabbing. Yeah, it doesn't have quite the resonance, obviously.
Right, it's kind of like muting a string on the regular neck of the guitar.
But yeah, you certainly can, and you know, maybe I'll work that into my next tune.
I get
my next composition.
Give me credit.
Yeah, I will.
Just kidding there. So let's back up a little bit. You were talking about the great educational opportunities that the Museum of Making Music offers. Absolutely true, not only for our visiting school children, but really anybody who walks in the door walks out having learned something about music products, about their desire to play an instrument perhaps, or pick up an instrument they used to play. So on your True Fire teaching channel, you've got a section about harp guitar. Now, have you found that is a good learning tool for your own students?
I found it's been great, because the way I've learned and the way I've really enjoyed learning is from human beings. You know, not from the sheet music, not from the videos, but to have somebody say, okay, you take your finger and you put it here and you get this sound and you try to get this sort of feel, and then you kind of push that beat back a little bit and push it forward, and all the little nuances that turn notes into music. And that's what it's about. And so that's much easier to get on a one-on-one basis. And with the True Fire channels, you can really get that. So you can request it a tune or request something about it, post a little video of you playing it, and I can respond back with a video. And you could do that just at the entry level. And then if you want to do more, there's a second level. And you could even take private lessons, one-on-one private lessons on there. So it's been really cool, and I've gotten great response. I'm putting a couple things together for the harp guitar section. I'm going to teach this one. So that can be done on a regular guitar, too, without the super trebles, without the sub basses, but it just, adds some really fun stuff when you've got the extra range to play with.
Absolutely. So much additional color. And really, it makes you sound like a three-piece ensemble. You know, if you were to close your eyes, I would guess there were three people playing that.
Yeah, and that's another thing that I found about compositions, is I can write things formerly I wrote for as a duet, and then I can put them together as a solo piece, or even three parts and put it together as a solo piece.
That's fantastic. So let me ask you, Muriel, the True Fire Teaching Channel, is this something that came about due to the stay at home, or had you had that in existence beforehand?
That was in existence long before, maybe a year and a half before the stay-at-home thing. And I started my teaching channel just a little bit before the stay-at-home thing. So it's been really great to have it this time.
Have you found the interest in it to have bumped up during stay-at-home?
Well, since we started it pretty close to the beginning, we can't really judge before and after. But that would be something good to ask people who have been doing it for a little bit longer.
Fantastic. I mean, I think this is something we're going to see more of because the capability is there for us now. And we do have some great questions coming in. So if I may, I'm going to ask you a couple of these.
Sure.
Here you go. I'm going to learn something new myself right now. This is an instrument I've never heard of. It says, is the harp guitar a great, great, great grandchild from the Theorbo family?
Oh, the Theorbo was very similar to the harp guitar. During the Renaissance period, there's a lot of interesting instruments with all different kinds of strings and configurations. A Theorbo has long, long sub-bass strings that reach way out. And so it's certainly, I bet it was an inspiration for the harp guitar. And we see them built in Europe. And they had kind of a Renaissance in America right between around 1890 to 1910 or so, 1920, perhaps. That was, that was back before video games, when the cool thing to do was to get together with a bunch of mandolins of all different sizes. And
right.
They have these great mandolin ensembles. So you see pictures of them played with that, because with the extra bass, it had a bigger sound and could hold up and accompanying that.
Have you ever had occasion to play one of those yourself?
The Theorbo?
Right.
No, I have not. It would be interesting, though. Yeah.
Sounds like a challenging instrument with the sub-bass strings so far out. And then one last question, which I think I know the answer to. Have you ever used open tuning on the standard strings?
Yes, I have. And one tuning that works very nicely, if you don't mind me taking some time to retune here, is a Dadgad. So this is where I tune the sixth string down to D, and then also the first string to D. And they're tuned D, A, D, G, A, D. And I'll play it a little louder. I have a little video, in fact, both on my YouTube channel and on the new Truefire channel, that shows how easy it is to compose in Dadgad. Almost all the good notes fall right in straight lines on your fingerboard. And so it's a really fun jumping off point. And then after that, you can play with it more. Let me just check the tuning of the subs. Okay, so I'll play just a little bit of this one, and I call this one Lady Pamela.
We're clicked back on, yes? Perfect. Right there was that joy, grace, and humor all over the one. When you started hitting those blue notes, there's the humor right there.
That's right. Well, that one also, you know, had I wanted a little different sound on a bass note. I wanted it an octave higher, but still having that bass sound. So I grabbed the harmonic, so the exact halfway point, and because there's no real marking where it is, and I have a lot of different instruments where things are in different spots, so I took a little magic marker and I put a little line on my string, so I know where that exact halfway point is to hit that harmonic.
If you hadn't told us, we wouldn't have known. Now I know that harmonic technique is not easy. I mean, to do it from a standstill is not easy, and yet you're moving and you jump up and grab it. That's amazing. Could you maybe describe how that happens? Because I think most guitarists know that the standard harmonics are on the 12th fret, and then you can get the others on the 7th and 5th. But there is a way to get harmonics all the way up and down the length of the string, and it's a little trick that maybe you could share with us here.
Sure, there's a lot of different ways to do harmonics. So I've got a whole course on it. it's a big subject. But they are really fun. So what I'm doing here is I'm touching the exact halfway point with my index finger and then plucking behind with my thumb. And that way my left hand is free, so I can do that on any note. And so I'm no longer limited to just a couple of places where the natural harmonics fall. And then a technique I learned from Chet Atkins is you can take that little harmonic and then intersperse a natural note with one of your fingers that's hanging down here, and interspersing a harmonic with a regular note, when you have them about the same volume, makes them all sound like harmonics. So then I thought, well, if you could do that with one note, why not a harmonic and two notes? And so I came up with this technique that I use. I'll play the tune, use it on the nylon string harp guitar here. And I call this one View from Space.
That is so lovely. And now there's a story behind View from Space, is there not?
Yes, a couple of stories. We had talked about, you know, starting with one part, a duet, and then turning it into a solo. So that was originally written with two parts, because I figured that doing this harmonic technique, that takes, yeah, it uses up all my fingers, right? That's all I could do. So then I had a bass play this part, and then a melody play the other part. But then I found that I could play a note and with this finger and do a harmonic with the other two at the same time and work in the melody at the same time and then grab some bass notes. So, and that was really needed for that tune because the inspiration came about when I was asked to play at the annual Fajita Fest for the astronauts in Houston. And there, astronaut Susan Helms picked up my heartstrings recording and took it with her on the space shuttle Discovery. And she told me it was good music to watch the Earth by. So when I saw some of the images that came down, that was the inspiration for A View from Space.
Wow. I mean, I think you're probably the only artist I've ever heard of who has been complimented by an astronaut on their music, saying it's good music to watch the Earth from space.
Allison Brown also had a different astronaut take one of her CDs up. So I know there's one more.
Awesome. That's nice. We're going to have Allison with us on July 31st.
Oh, so really? She's
that.
Great.
She is tremendous. I mean, yeah, absolutely. And Muriel, you know, we at the museum, as with most organizations, are very, very reliant on our volunteer group. One of our volunteers is a faithful watcher, listener to Mom at Home, and he always has great questions. He's got a question. His name is Joe Rogers, and he's asking if you can play the blues music on the harp guitar.
Oh, sure. Anything can be played on the harp guitar. I'm going to tweak my fingernails here. Brian, can you find some little fingernail sandpaper here? And while I'm doing that, can I answer another question?
Yeah, sure. Okay. Absolutely. What I wanted to do actually is kind of backpedal all the way to your beginnings as a musician. What got you interested? What was your first instrument? And then from there, take us to the guitar and eventually to the harp guitar.
Sure. My first instrument was the piano, because my mother taught piano lessons. And in fact, I remember reaching up to the piano, and she also had an organ, and I couldn't sit down and reach the pedals, so I rocked back and forth. I found, you know, 1 and 5, rocked back and forth and made up melodies, holding with my hands above my head. So that's how little I was, I think, playing the piano, and wrote my first tune from, I heard the doorbell ring, and I found those notes on the piano, and found they made a chord with my left hand, and then I could play that with a melody on the right hand, and I wrote some words for it. I couldn't write at that time, that was before kindergarten, so I composed some words to go with it. You know, that goes way back. But on a friend of the family, Adele Knight, was throwing away a little half-size guitar, a little Decca half-size guitar. I picked it up and started figuring out melodies on the 3 remaining strings, and it was an instant love.
So you kind of knew right off the bat when you picked that guitar up, this is the instrument that resonates with me.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, my parents had a hard time getting it out of my hands. You know, I just love the way it resonates against you as you play. You could feel what the music is doing. It's not separated like it is on the piano. You could actually touch those strings. And so I think that's what really attracted me to it, and it became my way of expression, my vehicle.
Well, I'm glad you resisted your parents when they tried to get it out of your hands. So you picked up the guitar, you obviously knew it was love at first note, and from there I would gather you moved up to another guitar, took lessons. How did that progress?
I played a folk guitar and in folk guitar lessons and strummed and sang, and you know, playing music with other people was always just part of what I thought everyone did. It was just like eating and breathing, and it was just so much fun to do that. And then eventually my teacher said she couldn't really teach me much more, and I went off to find a teacher and ended up at the Old Town School of Folk Music with Ray Tate, and then joined the school jazz band. And in college, I couldn't study bluegrass in college at that time. Now you can. You can actually study it in Kentucky. But the only way to study music was to study classical. And so I went in reluctantly to study classical and discovered this whole new world there. And I was learned these tunes like, and in my head, I was hearing that note, right? So I went off to search for an instrument that would make that sound, and I'd seen pictures of the harp guitar that would give me those low notes that I was reaching for that weren't on my guitar. Eventually I heard that Michael Hedges played the harp guitar, and he played in a totally different style, very rhythmic, he did a lot of like hammer-on pull-offs. Like this, and he kind of kept that going, you know. With that kind of an ostinato thing, and really made the whole thing into a dance. It was a performance art that he did. Brilliant musician, but a totally different type of music. And at that first concert that I went to hear him, I found an older couple who looked as out of place as I felt, because It was a pretty hardcore rock club that we were at. And I sat next to them. It turned out that that was Bob Hartman, who was writing a book on harp guitars and the instruments of the Larson brothers, who built Michael Hedges' guitar. And so that was how I first got to play a harp guitar, playing for Bob's book of the Larson brothers' guitars and mandolins in America.
Oh, really? Fate was kind of guiding you to where you needed to be, I would
say. Yeah, that's right.
Michael Hedges, among many players, was just mesmerizing, as are you. And in fact, confession time here, that's when I first heard the instrument, so naturally I assumed that's when the harp guitar came to be. Please tell me and everybody watching how wrong I am.
Well, it has quite an interesting history, and you can go to harpguitars.net to get some more history on that. Greg Miner has done some fantastic research into that. But we know that there is a guy named Knutsen, Chris Knutsen, an immigrant from Norway, I believe, and he started building these instruments with the extra resonating chamber here, and originally with just the chamber to augment the sound, and then he started putting strings on it, and we start some of the earliest instruments in America that he made. And then the Larson brothers were in Chicago, and they started building them about the same time. So this is right the very end of the 1800s, very beginning of 1900s, they were building these. And at the same time, I believe Lyon and Healy in Chicago, where I bought my first guitar, my first good guitar, they had built some. And my guitar teacher at that time got a call from the granddaughter of Joseph Bowman. And they had this old guitar factory in Chicago with all these old instruments in there. And sure enough, there was a harp guitar there. So Joseph Bowman had also built a harp guitar in Chicago. So we found that there's several. And Gibson guitars, they built one without the resonating chamber, just the straight stick that these strings attach to. And these are right about that time, and they stopped building the harp guitars. They fizzled out a little bit around 1920. I mean, this is when we started getting other types of guitars of interest. We started getting the electric guitar that would give plenty of volume, so the volume wasn't an issue anymore. And now we're starting to see a pretty good comeback of these instruments. A lot of builders now are making them.
You mentioned the Knutsen guitar and the Gibson guitar. We have one each of those makers in the museum, and they are fascinating to look at. Matter of fact, I'm looking at a photo right now in my volunteer training manual of the Gibson with simply the stick holding the bass strings. And now, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think I remember reading somewhere that harp guitars were sort of discovered in pawn shops at a certain point by folk musicians, and that began a resurgence, a rediscovery, if you will.
Yes, it did. And I know that Stephen Bennett has been a big inspiration for a lot of us. He got his grandfather's old harp guitar and started playing it, and has been playing for a very long time. And has brought a lot of us together to share all this information about the harp guitar in an annual event we call the Harp Guitar Gathering. So we have to credit Stephen for giving us the community that we have. And Andy Wahlberg also has been playing an old harp guitar for quite a long time. And John Doan had some made for him. I had mentioned that he plays with a super treble, so he's been an inspiration for the super trebles as well.
And I believe Dave mentioned when we started out here at 2 o'clock, that we had the harp guitar gathering at the museum one year.
Yes.
It was amazing. Our boardroom downstairs was basically a who's who of harp guitarists and harp guitars. If you think there's just kind of one design, think again, because there were so many amazing designs of this instrument on display there.
Yeah.
Can I ask a couple more questions
from
viewers? Great. So maybe in a minute we can do a little blues something mm-hmm. on the harp guitar if you're feeling it. But we have another tremendous volunteer named Randy Harris, wonderful volunteer, but he's also a luthier. And maybe today we'll inspire him to build a harp guitar. Who knows? He's built some beautiful six-string acoustic guitars. And he's got a couple of questions. Do you use acrylics on your nails? I imagine the harp guitar is tough on the fingers. Let's start with that one.
No, these are natural nails, and that's why I sanded them after playing the steel string harp guitar. My main instrument is a nylon string like this. So I had one built by Mike Doolin, and this one here was built by Mike Britton, and he took some of the ideas of the Doolin guitar, which is smaller here. So this is tuned up a whole step. So, and the whole idea is to fit in the overhead bin of an airplane. So that was the prerequisite. And then, so I found it has this, you know, really nice, lovely sound, you know, different kind of a sound tuned up. And with the nylon strings, I can get a lot of different sounds with using the different combinations of fingernail and fingertip. And so it's really fun to play with, to be expressive on it. And the steel string harp guitar I was playing here, that after I play a few tunes, I have to sand my nails. And I've been using this, it comes from Luthier Music in New York. They're Luthier cloth nail files. So little bits of sand cloth. And this is getting all the way to 800 grade. And so, 8,000 grades. So, you know, that'll sand scratches out of airplane windows, you know, that. And so that if I keep the edge of my nail sanded very smooth and, you know, keep after it, then it glides right across and I don't need the acrylic nails.
Fantastic. Okay. We've got another question from Joe Rogers. Do the harmonics change as you move your picking right hand farther from the sound hole? So I guess we're going back to the harmonic technique you were showing us.
Oh, this is if you're doing a two-handed harmonic. I was doing the one-handed, so the position of the right hand has to do with the exact halfway point of the string. So that's fixed. You can't change that. If I'm using my left hand to find the harmonic, then I'll want to find that spot pretty close to the bridge where it's a little brighter sound. If I play it more in the middle, it's a little more subdued. So doing the two-handed harmonic, yes, I do move back a little bit here. So it's two different types of things.
So the one-handed harmonic then, just to clarify for everyone, basically you need to be in a fixed position, which is essentially 12 frets above where you're playing with your right hand.
Right,
correct?
So open, it's exactly 12th fret then. One fret up with my right hand for every one fret up with my left hand. And that keeps it at the exact halfway point.
I think when you do it, when we saw you doing it, the movement is so subtle that people might not have picked up on that. So thank you for clarifying that.
Yeah, I'll do another harmonic tune later on if you'd like to show you.
Absolutely,
that.
Yeah. I don't want to put you on the spot, but if you got some little bluesy you want to throw out there, a little bit of that.
I'll do it on this guitar. Change the tuning here. Now this harp guitar has only 5 sub-bass strings, so I have to decide which notes I'm going to play and which ones I'm not going to. So in case I wanted to play an extra low note, I have this rigged up with a Scruggs tuner. So that's a banjo tuner there that'll allow me to do a little bluesy motion there if I want to. Okay, so we have. Okay, a little Thelonious Monk here. Mm-hmm. Oh, you could play any kind of music on the instrument. Just that's a cool tune. You know, I just thought if I had a few more bass strings, I should play it on the other one with the 7 extra bass strings. I might work out a little arrangement of that one.
That was sweet. I mean, that's the Friday afternoon blues cafe right there.
That's right.
Now, you say this guitar has only the 5 sub-bass strings. Is that a standard design for that maker? Or would you be able to say to the luthier, you know what, I want 8, I want 10, I want 12?
I just ordered another one from him with 7 sub-basses. I said, make it just like this, but with 7, because I really like that. So we can do that. And it's really cool now that there's some incredible builders and some that have streamlined it a little bit, and so the harp guitars are not as expensive as they used to be to get a good one. Before, you could either get one that was completely unplayable, or you'd have to pay a minimum of $4,000 because they're difficult to make, you know. And so now we're finally getting some builders, you know, in between there who are making great instruments.
So what would that kind of in-between average price point be at this now?
You know, around, it runs the gamut. But you can get a pretty good harp guitar for $2,000, around that, a little less, you know. And so they're difficult to build. It's a lot more to it than making a regular guitar.
Absolutely. And you can very easily pay $2,000 for a standard 6-string guitar these days.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah,
I think that's right in the pocket. So now, you don't walk into a guitar store and see harp guitars hanging on the shelf. Is each one a custom order with a luthier, or do they build them for sort of mass market consumption?
Well, there's some that have tried doing it. I know that Holloway Harp Guitars for a while was building the Dyer model. That's what the Larson brothers created. And they were trying to do them kind of in a more of a factory setting and with a lower price point. And they have gone to just doing the high-end harp guitars now. So we see some of those still around, but I believe that they're now doing the, you know, just the high-end. And you get some Chinese copies, but as I mentioned, that those are, from what I've heard, that the tuners don't hold because it's a lot of tension on the string, and so they're not really a player's instrument. So they're not really playable as far as what I've heard. I don't have one myself. Yeah,
I have picked up several of their steel string acoustic guitars, and they've been lovely. But you bring up a point there. The tension, obviously the tension on a standard 6-string is huge. And if I'm correct here, it goes up exponentially from a nylon to a steel string. If I'm not, bring me back on the rails. But certainly with the addition of the bass strings and then super trebles that are built in, the tension has to go up just dramatically, yes?
Yes, I would say. And I don't really know how they do it. How do they do it to keep all these strings stable, you know?
And I know bracing has a lot to do with it in a standard guitar. I have to confess my ignorance. I don't know if inside the extra neck there's a bracing scheme there.
All sorts of different types of bracing that we see.
All the way up, yeah.
Yeah, so it's fun to look at them going through the X-ray machine at the airport.
Fun and a little scary, I'm going to have to guess, yes? Muriel, every musician, as he or she is coming up in the world, learning their instrument, is inspired by one person, several people. Would you be able to cite some of your inspirations, people that really got you turned on to go, wow? I mean, you mentioned Michael Hedges. I know that was a game changer for you.
Certainly was. And when I first got my harp guitar, it just looked like a sea of strings when I looked down. I didn't know what to do with it. And I asked Stephen Bennett about it, and he said, well, just play one sub bass when it adds to the music. And then, and that's all. Sometimes it's just the extra resonating chamber just makes the regular guitar sound good. So just enjoy that. And so it kind of took away the fear that you have to do something with these strings. So some tunes I don't use these strings much at all. Other tunes I use them a lot. So it's to the service of the music. And you want your music to have variety. If you use them all the time, then you no longer have variety. And so they're to expand the variety of what you're doing. And
okay.
Yeah, John Doan was a big influence too, I mentioned, and Claude Leflemme, a great player from Canada. He also has super trebles, and I learned one of his tunes, and so he was an inspiration there.
So a lot of people on your journey have sort of gotten you to say, wow, let me try this, let me try that. And yeah. You know, it adds to your palate as a performer, absolutely.
Yeah.
Fantastic. We are kind of coming up on the hour, and I want to be respectful of your time and our viewers' time, but if you wouldn't mind, maybe, because we've talked about education, how important that is. You are a teacher yourself. You mentor young students. If someone comes to you and says, gosh, that's such a lovely instrument. I've never played guitar. I've never had my hands on anything like it. What? How would you set them on that path to start from the very beginning to learn how to play that beautiful instrument?
Well, it's easier to address on a one-to-one basis because those things are different for each person. Everyone's journey is different, and everyone has a little different way to get there. In fact, if you want to stop by that link that we had mentioned that's on MurielAnderson.com/now, I put a couple things special for this today. I put 7 days free. I'm going to call Brian over here in a minute. Also, there's a link to harpguitars.net, and that's where you can find out about the history. So if you want to check out the True Fire channel that we've been talking about, we have a special all pass, you know, for a whole week.
And that's a great way for people to jump on board and get started. And as you were talking, you reminded me that I need to ask you about the harp ukulele, too. We wanted to look at that that fun little instrument.
Yes, we had talked about Chris Knutsen. He was living in Seattle at that time, way early on, when they were just starting to make the harp guitars. And there he heard the Hawaiian music the first time and saw the ukuleles come over. And so he, in addition to the regular harp guitar, he decided to put some on this instrument over here. We've got a little helicopter going overhead.
So, you can hear it very well.
Yeah, okay. Brian, can you hand me that instrument, please? Can you hand me that instrument? Let's play a tune. Yeah. So this is... we happen to have one of these here. And so you think that's, if you were going to be putting extra strings on an instrument, you wouldn't start with an ukulele, right? So it was kind of fun. So I'll just do a little bit of it so you can hear the sound of it. We're just going to go right into the mic here so you can see that.
Sure, that'll work. Thank you, Brian, for joining us.
That gentle little sound of the harpalele there. We call
so
it a harpalele.
Harpalele. And Brian was employing a technique that really creates a beautiful sound, especially on a nylon instrument when you are brushing the strings with your fingertips.
Yes, yeah. That's
fantastic.
That's lovely. So
fantastic. Well, Muriel, this has just been beyond expectations. It's been fantastic. And I think people have learned a lot about an instrument that maybe they knew some about, maybe they knew nothing about. And if you'd like, I'd love to have you play us out.
Sure, I'll do that.
Thank you very much.
So I'll play it on my other harp guitar. So this one is... this one is actually made with carbon fiber. So out here by the ocean, where we are this time of year, the humidity is a little hard on those larger wood instruments. So I use either the small harp guitar or this one. And I also have one for travel that I use, especially when I'm going to Europe. That folds up into a backpack. 20-string harp guitar comes apart and folds up. That's made by Luke Brunner. I also have a link on that same page where I have all the links, the slash now, where you can check out his super trebles and the folding harp guitars.
That would be something to see. So let me just remind everybody then while you're tuning, please do make it a point to go to MurielAnderson.com/now. I looked at it earlier today, and it literally is a cornucopia of information about the harp guitar and about Muriel's journey, about her offerings on this absolutely unique and beautiful instrument. So Muriel, again, on behalf of the Museum of Making Music, all of our viewers with the questions, some who are simply viewing with no questions coming in, we just want to say thank you very, very much, and wish you continued success on your harp guitar journey.
All right, thank you. So I think we are raring to go now. Something from Acoustic Chef. Sur le ciel de Paris s'en va une chanson. Elle est née d'aujourd'hui dans le cœur d'un garçon. Sur le ciel de Paris marchent les amoureux. Le bonheur se construit sur un effet paru. Sur le pont de Bercy, un philosophe assis, deux musiciens, quelques bardons, puis les gens amis. Sur le ciel de Paris, jusque soir on chantait. L'une des les belles prépris dans sa vieille cité, près de Notre-Dame. Parfois couvre drame, oui mais par rame, tout peut s'arranger. Quelques rayons du ciel d'été, l'accordéon d'un marinier, l'espoir fleurit au ciel de Paris. Le ciel de Paris a son secret pour lui. Depuis 20 siècles, il était pris dans notre île de Saint-Louis. Quand il est trop jaloux de ses milliers, il fait grandir chez nous son tonnerre éclatant. Yeah. Merci beaucoup. Oh, I forgot to mention the name of this. This is this instrument is an emerald guitar that's built in Ireland. And my other one is Mike Doolin, built in Portland, Oregon.
Yep. Wonderful. Tremendous. Luthiers. And one more time, the name of that lovely song, Muriel?
That's Under Paris Skies, Sous le Ciel de Paris.
Fantastic. And that's on your newest release?
Yeah, that's right. And each song has an accompanying recipe. So, of course, that is with quiche. The recipe for quiche goes with that.
Very happy dancing quiche, I'm going to add. That was so lovely. Thank you again, Muriel. And Dave, if you're ready, why don't we go ahead and
thank you, Bill,
and bring it to a close. Thank you so much.
Wow, that was incredible. That just set the whole tone for the weekend. I feel so relaxed. As a matter of fact, I almost fell asleep listening to that. I enjoyed it so much. I haven't had sleep for the last few days, so that was wonderful. Thank you, Muriel. Thank you, Brian.
Okay, thank you.
Playing that ukulele harp. That was wonderful. That was great.
Brian, thank you.
That wraps up another MoMM show here. Wonderful one. Join us again in 2 weeks. We won't be around next week because of the holidays, but we will welcome Steph Johnson on July 10th and her musical journey. She will also be performing on a live stream from the museum on Saturday, July 11th at 7 p.m. You can stay up to date with all of our events and our renovation updates at www.museumofmakingmusic.org. So everybody with this wonderful send-off, have a great weekend.